I was born on June 10th, 1916 in Massachusetts and was brought up in the Dorchester neighborhood of Boston as one of the four children to my parents, Nathan and Phoebe Rosenberg. My father owned a grocery store that unfortunately fell victim to the Great Depression, so I decided to quit school and start working. Now, I'm sure you can imagine that an 8th grade dropout with no real qualifications or experience would probably have to work a lot of odd jobs. And that's exactly what I did. I delivered groceries, shined shoes, and even sold ice. I transported a block of ice to the New Hampshire racetracks and sold them as ice chips, making $171 in one night. Supporting my family at a young age was not easy, but I was determined. I worked to deliver telegrams, and the faster I worked, the more commission I'd get. It wasn't long until I started to excel at it, proving that with ambition and hard work, you can, in fact, do anything. I didn't stay there for long though. At the age of 17, I started selling ice cream out of trucks for 3 years until the draft board got in touch with me. World War II saw me in need of an essential job if I didn't want to be drafted into the army. So once again, I left home and found myself at a shipyard in Quincy. I refused to settle for a minimum wage job as I truly felt that I deserved more. They offered me a position as an electrician with the maximum amount of salary they could afford, but quickly realized that I did not really know how to be an electrician. But I did not let this be an issue for long and quickly adapted all the skills required to become an expert in the field. Ironically, the most important lesson I took from this experience had nothing to do with my actual job. What I noticed was that my fellow workers didn't have access to proper food, an essential necessity. I decided to seize this opportunity and jumped at the chance to provide just that. Using $1,000 from my savings and $1,500 from my bonds, I started industrial luncheon services and served sandwiches, espresso, donuts, and snacks out of an old telephone company truck. I slowly realized that what people were missing was great coffee. Back then, the coffee that most people drank was either burnt or was essentially just really diluted bean water, which I know sounds quite unappetizing. So this was another turning point in my career. I decided that I was going to sell not just good coffee, but the best coffee. In 1948, I stepped up from running food trucks and opened the Open Kettle instead. Despite the popular opinion that selling coffee for a total of 10 cents was a little nuts, I did really well, netting over $5,000 every week. And as much as I'd like to say it was the coffee, the secret to the success of my little business was the variety of donuts that we offered. Almost 52 flavors, which back then was unheard of. But something irked me about the name Open Kettle. It just didn't suit the brand. And so I started looking for a name that made sense. Soon I noticed everyone liked dunking their donuts in their coffee, bringing about the perfect name for the shop, Dunkin' Donuts. However, I didn't start this alone. I had a partner, Harry Winokur, who was in fact my brother-in-law. And you know how they always say don't mix business with family? Well, our story is an excellent example as to why that's good advice. As Dunkin's grew in popularity, I wanted to use the newfound love that the general population had for our coffee to expand. I wanted as many people as possible to enjoy our delicious coffee and donuts just before they went to work or school or anytime they had a craving, really. In order to do that, we needed to franchise. But Harry didn't exactly share the same views, and unfortunately, he misunderstood the situation. He felt that I was always under the limelight and took most of the credit for our success. So, in a fit of anger and jealousy, he decided that he didn't want to have a stake in Dunkin' Donuts anymore. I did not let this get in the way of the business and went ahead with my plans to expand. In 1955, the first franchise store opened in Dedham, and by the year 1963, we opened our 100th store. The business was thriving, but I was tired and decided to hand over the business to my 25-year-old son, Robert, who, as a Harvard graduate, was ready to take over. While in charge, Robert did me proud and smoothed over a lot of our problems.
Hakuna Matata! It means no worries!
Our menu was all over the place. Some branches served a range of sandwiches and burgers, while others offered a wide menu of breakfast options, which, as you can imagine, didn't do good things for our reputation. We moved to paper and styrofoam cups and presented biscuits, bagels, croissants, breakfast sandwiches, culottas, and different drinks. In addition to introducing a national advertising program, Robert began to offer franchises to multi-unit administrators, introduced satellite areas, and later a grocery store framework, every one of which helped fuel development by removing the need for buildings big enough to house donut manufacturing and production. When we moved into Texas, the result was disastrous, as 6 out of the 10 new stores closed and the franchisees blamed the corporate office for not advertising or paying enough attention to their stores. The company was bleeding money as more franchisees sued us for violation of the contract for allegedly focusing more on getting new contracts than helping the existing ones. When Bob heard of this, he was so upset that he literally vomited and was ashamed to break the news of the company's current state to me. The board of directors almost fired him until he introduced fried donut holes, which soon became Dunkin' Shining Stars. They were aptly called Munchkins. Not only did the franchisee sales grow, but so did their trust in the company, saving them from their looming doom. Our first international store opened in Japan in 1970, and by 1979, the 1,000th store opened in the United States. I personally still made international trips to my franchisees, checking on their upkeep. I truly believe that the more success we got, the more attention to detail we required, for it was their insistence on excellence that made our fortune. We had realized that our company's growth was still not up to our expectations. We needed to gain the trust of our customers back, and we thought the best way to achieve that was through advertising. After holding hundreds of auditions, we settled on Michael Vail. Our first TV ad, Fred the Baker, an ad that encapsulated the everyday man and his routine of hard work, dramatizing Dunkin's brand, delicious products everyone can afford. By 1983, we had more than 12,000 stores in malls, shopping centers, and restaurants throughout the Northeast. When new stores opened, I would always be there, beaming as I cut the ribbon and offered coffee to customers, feeling like the king of coffee. On September 22, 2002, I lost my battle to bladder cancer and passed away at my home in Massachusetts. But the legacy of Dunkin' Donuts surpassed me and still brings joy to every customer today, and that makes me feel at peace. My name is William Rosenberg, and I am the founder of Dunkin' Donuts. If you guys liked that video, please hit the like button. It does wonders for the YouTube algorithm. Just the research and the editing alone of these type of videos takes us close to 18 hours. So we would really appreciate it if you could check out our Patreon. For just $1 a month, you can support our work. We produce over like 12 videos per month, so that's literally 8 cents per video. Thanks so much, guys. Peace out.